from a technology perspective, Palmer, you've been working on this in secret and stealth for a couple of years. What is new here? What is the technology at play?
Well, Roadrunner is an AI-piloted autonomous air vehicle. It's got a lot of cool features. It's powered by two twin turbojet thrust-vectored engines. It's very, very fast, carries a significant payload. It's very maneuverable. But the really cool thing about it is that it can be reused. It's actually a vertical takeoff and landing vehicle. And that means that with certain payloads, you can go out there, perform the mission, come back, re-land, and then refuel, rearm, and use it again. With other payloads, let's say a one-way warhead to go up against a large aircraft, I can send a whole swarm of Roadrunners out there, and only the ones that actually engage the target are consumed. Everyone else can come home, and that allows you to have much greater effective magazine depth and to use these things in a way that you can't use traditional one-way missiles, where once you launch it, it's gone, whether you launch a bunch of them or one of them.
Palmer, we share with our audience at the top of this segment, Ashley Vance wrote about it in his story, that the U.S. plans to put this to deployment next year, right? But so much of the news flow around drones has been in the context of the war in Ukraine. You know, drones are a key strategy for both sides, it seems. Do you see Roadrunner being deployed in Ukraine in the near term? What kind of talks have you had around that?
Well, I'll tell you this. I see it in my mind's eye. But whether it goes there isn't up to me. It's up to a bunch of people in the U.S. government. You know, the foreign military sales process, the transfer process, is government-driven rather than company-driven the vast majority of the time. And we've been in Ukraine since the second week of the war, not just with our products, but also sending people over there. I actually was in Kyiv to meet with Zelensky for the second time. I met with him ahead of the war because he was interested in purchasing our technology to help secure their eastern border. Unfortunately, that wasn't something we were able to make happen because of those restrictions that I mentioned earlier. And so it's certainly something that I would love to see personally.
What about demand from Europe in and of itself, Palmer?
So, I mean, we have a lot of European customers, and we do a lot of work in particular with the United Kingdom and the UK Royal Marines especially. But, you know, there's a little bit of a tricky dynamic with some European countries. Some European countries really see their defense apparatus as a way to run a jobs program, and they are forcing us, companies like Anduril, to compete with their own domestic capabilities. It might not be as advanced, might be years behind, might be more expensive, but it's pretty hard for them to get over the fact that they would be dropping that internal program to buy something from an American company. It's a difficult pill to swallow for some of these countries, especially ones that do have what anyone would consider a pretty strong defense industry of their own.
One country that has a strong defense industry of their own is China, and you've been outspoken on this. We've heard, of course, not only about China's strength in defense, but also their strength in AI. And, of course, you're twinning the two here. I'm interested as to how much those conversations surrounding Taiwan, the concerns there, are building, and whether or not it's actually something that you are having conversations with the DoD about.
I mean, it's all about that. Everyone is talking about making sure that the capabilities that we're building today are ready to go for a fight in the Pacific in 2027 or earlier, because that is the latest that we see China trying to launch an offensive. For a variety of reasons, that's the timing for some kind of action against Taiwan, which is critical to our economy. You know, there's a lot of places around the world that we call partners. There's a lot of places around the world that we say are important to our interests. Taiwan and their semiconductor industry is really about as important as it gets, especially for such a small country so close to China. The good news is I think people are recognizing this threat. Big tech companies years ago thought that China was someone that was going to be a huge growth market for them. They thought they were going to get in and sell them social media, sell them services. And I think people are starting to realize that that's not what's happening. They're coming here and they're eating our lunch. And that is, I think, positive for tech companies' decision to start working with the DoD again.
Palmer, there's an intense interest in Anduril. People don't know that much about the company. So if we take the kind of Taiwan case study, Roadrunner aside, what are the products and technologies that you can offer that you would deploy in I get a hypothetical scenario like that?
Well, our core product is something called Lattice AI. It's kind of the AI engine that powers all of our products. We actually have more people at Anduril working on software than hardware, even though we have over a dozen hardware products. And that's because Lattice is something or software investment is something that can reach across all these systems and a lot of external systems. Lattice AI is integrated with more third-party products than Anduril-made products even. So we make loitering munitions like the Altius line. We make autonomous underwater vehicles like the Dive submarine. We make counter UAS systems, electronic warfare systems, surveillance systems, tactical UAS systems like the Ghost helicopter drone. We've got a lot of things that could make a really big difference. And again, everything that we're doing and most of what the DoD is doing is preparing for a conflict with a great power like China in the Pacific on a near-term time frame. Anything that we make that is not going to be ready to go into that type of fight, whether it's a blockade or a real invasion, is not something that I think is particularly relevant or worth heavy investment.
Palmer, when I posted on social media you were coming on the show, I guess the most common question from the audience was about manufacturing. You know, if you take Roadrunner as an example, they know it's a cutting-edge technology, but they actually want to know more about how you scale the output of that product.
Well, there's a few things that go into that. You know, first of all, Anduril is a defense product company more than a defense contractor. We use our own money to decide what to build, how to build it, and then we build it and sell it when it's done. And that's very different than companies that get paid more when they have, let's say, an inefficient manufacturing process or a longer manufacturing process because they're on a cost-plus contract. And our head of manufacturing comes from Tesla, where he scaled several lines to very, very large numbers of vehicles. We have a lot of other people who have experience making consumer electronics on a very tight schedule. We've done 5 new revisions of Sentry Tower, 4 new revisions of our Ghost drone in just 5 or 6 years. And so we're on more of a consumer electronics manufacturing and iteration cycle than any traditional defense company would be. And look, my previous company was Oculus VR. I started that when I was 19 years old, living in a camper trailer, sold it to Facebook for a few $1 billion, was there for a few years before getting fired. But while I was there, we made millions of virtual reality headsets in China. I know how China does things. I know how these things can be done, and I'm trying to bring a little bit of that Chinese energy here to U.S. manufacturing, absent all the stuff that I hate about China.
Interesting perspective on what you can learn, perhaps, even though you dislike parts of what's evident. And Palmer, to that point, I mean, everyone's currently hand-wringing about artificial intelligence, U.S. versus China, China versus everyone. I mean, you've just been in the U.K., I mean, just at least saying that you've been building relationships there, and we just think about the U.K. AI summit, where, what was it, 31 countries signed up to some sort of guardrails when it comes to, well, the acceleration of deployment of AI in the military. What do you make of these moves to putting guardrails in artificial intelligence's use within military?
A lot of these are decades behind. The U.S. government has been thinking about these things literally for decades. It really bothers me when people say, oh man, we need to come up with rules that tell the DoD what to do about AI. I mean, they haven't been thinking about these things. They don't understand how important autonomous weapons can be. What are you talking about? The U.S. government's been deploying autonomous weapons like radar-seeking missiles and missiles that can differentiate between targets for decades now. Look at something like a CRAM or a CWIS, the automated guns that are protecting our bases and our ships from incoming mortar fire, incoming artillery fire, incoming missile and rocket fire. Those are autonomous weapons. They're making decisions about what to shoot down and what to not without a person manually deciding what to do beyond deciding to turn on the system and allow it to engage targets, period. So the U.S. government has very strong doctrine around this that really boils down to making sure a human is always responsible for any decision. And that doesn't mean that the person's responsible for pulling the trigger. I hate this idea too. People say, well, can't you agree that an AI should never be able to decide when to pull the trigger? And I don't agree with that because I don't think there's any moral high ground in making, let's say, a landmine that can't tell the difference between a school bus full of children and a Russian tank column. I think that it is good for it to be able to decide when to pull the trigger, as long as a person is taking responsibility for that employment and whatever goes wrong in the end. And so I'd say a lot of this is performative. There are people who have never thought about AI, never thought about weapons until very recently, and they're now declaring themselves to be AI safety experts. And they are decades behind the people who have actually been working on autonomous weapons policy and ethics and guidelines. I think the United States is clearly far and away the leader in this space.
Palmer, I just wanted to point out, you know, when I put on social media coming on the show, of course, there are a body of people out there that don't agree with the use of any technology in the context of war because they don't want to have any consideration of war, right? They believe in peace, frankly. It would be remiss of me not to ask you as well about Oculus. You mentioned it in your prior answer. I think we're almost at the 10-year anniversary of then Facebook acquiring then your company, Oculus. Over the last 10 years, where have we landed in VR and AR? This year we had MetaQuest 3, we had Vision Pro from Apple. Just give me your assessment of the technology field for headsets.
Well, on the people who think that we shouldn't be using tech in any of this stuff, I'd say let's arm NATO with sticks and stones and water guns and see how that goes for you guys. As far as VR, I'm really excited with how it's going. I am happy to see a lot of my deeply held technical beliefs playing out in the market. One example is the Apple Vision Pro being kind of an augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality combo headset that is doing full reprojection of the world, where it's capturing the world using sensors and then using all new photons to project into your eyes, rather than an optically transparent AR system that a lot of people were trying to build over the last decade. I've always been on the hard AR full reprojection side. Happy to see that kind of panning out with Apple. I've used the new Apple headset. It's amazing. Probably the best accomplishment that I've done on the VR side was making sure that VR came back from the dead. It is now something that other people are working on, so that for the rest of my life, I'm going to be able to go out and buy really nice virtual reality headsets without having to do it myself, which is what I was doing when I was 15 and 16 starting Oculus.